for that. But I wanted to take 5 minutes and point out, which is kind of one of these ironic things in life. So the way I first encountered this guy was when I was a professor at University of, or research fellow at University of Western Australia in the mid-1990s, which was a great job. It had no duties. I didn't have to teach. I didn't have to even publish papers or do anything. They just paid me to sit there and think for like 3 years. So that was very nice. I'm thankful to the Australian government. And amazingly, I quit that job before it was done to move to New York and start an AI company. I've been suffering ever since. But at University of Western Australia, I had a PhD student who actually I had met in Las Vegas when I was a professor there. He'd moved, Japanese guy, he moved from Vegas to New Zealand to Australia with me. And what he was doing for his PhD was quite similar to the stuff that Dave Damaris just described. And I was just looking for his thesis online. I couldn't find it. But we were looking at nonlinear dynamics foundation for psychophysics. So looking at nonlinear dynamics models of seeing, hearing, and smelling, actually. We were with the various different senses. And this is what we were thinking of as a reaction diffusion model. Of the vision, for example. So we had took a lattice, and in each square of the lattice, we had this nonlinear recursion, which was different than the logistic equation, but similar in spirit. And then we diffuse the values from the recursion to the neighboring cells. So we had a linear diffusion, then this nonlinear, often chaotic reaction in each cell. And we tried to use that to simulate various perceptual illusions. And we did a similar simulation for olfaction, which didn't involve a square lattice, but involved just a completely coupled network of these things. And we simulated visual and olfactory illusions, which olfactory illusions are interesting. Like, you can get something that tastes sweet, even though there's no sugar in it. So it combined like three things, none of which taste sweet on their own or in any binary combination, but they taste sweet in a ternary combination. So we're trying to simulate various weird aspects of human psychophysics. Now that
the one that I've fiddled with that I still find exciting, maybe because I never got to the end, or do you have the diffusion, but in each square you put some finite state machine?
Well,
and they're all running the same finite state code, yeah. But then you
you can do that.
React, yeah. Along.
What we did, we
were just substituting a finite state machine for a differential equation.
Yeah, we were using this.
Simplifies it.
This difference equation that was come up by this difference equation came up with by a guy named Robert Gregson, who was in Melbourne. He was a mathematical psychologist, and it's a little more complicated than the logistic equation, but Gregson had a book called Nonlinear Psychophysical Dynamics, where he presented a bunch of equations and simulations, and he argued that using this recursion rather than the logistic would...
Well, this is why I'm saying finite state machine, is you can sort of enumerate all of them and see how each different one behaves, and say, oh, here are the interesting ones, here are the boring ones.
Yeah.
So rather than working at just one,
I guess when you're sort of notionally simulating neurons in cortical sheath, then continuous variables just seem more natural.
Well, yeah, no, I'm simulating DNA.
Yeah, but here they're simulating neurons, which is why it seemed more natural to do it this way. But
even neurons, you have calcium channels that open for a while and close for a while.
Sure.
These concentrations hit, so you have these, it's like nothing. All the channels open.
I think
open,
you
open,
can
open,
sort of put a lot of different nonlinear things in the squares and get similar dynamics. So the challenge that Gregson was trying to meet was getting the most sort of human perception-like dynamics from the least number of parameters. Really. But you can do a lot of different ways. That's what he had. He had this complex variable cubic recursion, And then the real part is what you take as the output signal. Then there's the gain parameter there, which is A. And then the input signal was U, which is sort of weight within the gain parameter. So you give that input there, U, that determines the gain parameter A. Then you run this thing like 50 times or something, and take the real part of the output after running it 50 times, and that's your output. And that's sort of a weird thing to do, but what he showed is that you can simulate psychophysics in a lot of different experiments, and the kinds of scaling that the human brain seems to do. So between the actual signal that comes in and the signal as it's perceived by the brain. So Goertzel did that. What my PhD student Sakuo did was kind of similar to what Dave did. I mean, he put one of these things in each square of a lattice, for example, and did some diffusion, and then you see what happens. And we found a lot of weird stuff there. So one thing we did, and unfortunately, I couldn't find any of Takuo's old pictures online. They exist somewhere. But for example, if you look at an illusion like Muller-Lyer illusion, so the illusion here is these lines are the same length, but typically when looking at this, people will judge this one to be longer than this one. And so what you find is if you imprint this or this in a reaction diffusion lattice of that nature, what happens is for this one, this line actually stretches out, and for this one, the line actually compresses. So you get, and we show this for a bunch of different illusions. So you get the lattice sort of emulates the visual illusion that people have, and that's not incredibly deep, but it didn't have to happen. It was sort of cool. That doesn't happen if you're doing linear stuff.
So another interesting thing about this is. The psychophysics of where people's eyes land on an image like this when you're looking at it, as we know, we're moving eyes around. So in the top one, your eyes will sort of land outside in FY, so in that junction. And in the bottom one, your eyes will tend towards the inside of the arrows in the space in between. So, but yeah, also I would find that kind of, because I did this same processing, I guess, in my master's thesis.
Uh-huh. Also works with a logistic equation.
I don't know if the bar shortening was exactly the same, but I think it was something kind of like that. And there were also these artifacts that I could, like these little islands would well up somewhere from the reaction diffusion process, especially if you did a quench at the end, which is like one of these time varying parameter things. And I would say, like, huh, I wonder if that's a way of, like, finding the points where the eye should go to sample the distribution, because all of the critical information is there about inflection points, for example.
So we were just starting, actually, to use floating point GA from, like, oh, I forget the guy's, Michalowicz, or some Russian neighborhood floating point GA algorithm. We were just starting with that, and then I quit academia and she moved to New York to start a company, and Takuo finished his PhD, but we didn't push it any further. But I started corresponding with Dave a bit at that point, and then I kind of dropped it off because I moved on to other stuff. And then unexpectedly, David Hansen recruited Dave to work on Hansen Robotics, so we intersected again. But I think, yeah, there's a tendency in science and technology for everyone to jump on the same trend and make the same exact models. So that's striking these like deep convolutional networks and autoencoders, as Ralph is playing with. Now, that's cool, and there's interesting stuff there, but yeah, there are so many other interesting models which highlight different aspects of how the biological systems work and have different interesting dynamical properties, and it's definitely suboptimal that so much resources is put on one very specific, albeit interesting, way of looking at things, and then everything else is...
Science is trendy.
Yeah, it's
the old scientist Lagore say, hey, it looks like the party's over there. I think I'm going to go join the party.
Yeah, especially when the party involves a lot of funding.
Well,
it's a money party. So,
feed forward, feed back.
Yeah. All right, so let's take a 5-minute break or something, and we can talk about some more crazy stuff.